In this video, we'll create a simple Jakarta Persistence application in IntelliJ IDEA Ultimate. Jakarta Persistence is the new name for the Java Persistence APIs, also known as JPA. These APIs allow you to store, access, and manage Java objects in a relational database. Let's start by creating a new project in IntelliJ IDEA. We'll select Java Enterprise from the left menu, which allows us to take advantage of the Enterprise framework support provided in IntelliJ IDEA Ultimate. In this tutorial, I'll use the latest long-term supported Java version, which is Java 11. Then I'll select Library for my template. I won't be using any application server for my persistence application, so I will not configure the application server field. Everything else looks good, so I'll select Next. In the next window, we'll select the libraries required by my application. I want to use the latest available APIs, so I'll select Jakarta EE 9 from the drop-down menu. For a persistence application, we need the persistence APIs and an implementation for those APIs. So I will select persistence under specifications, then I will choose Eclipse Link as my implementation. Then click Next. I'll give my project a name, in this case I'll call it Jakarta Persistence App, and change the group to my company name. Then click Finish. IntelliJ IDEA will create the project and generate some files for us. First, let's take a look at our pom.xml file. You'll notice that IntelliJ IDEA generated some dependencies that we need for our application. In addition to these dependencies, our application will also need the dependencies needed for the database where we'll be persisting our data. In this tutorial, I'll use a lightweight database called Hypersql. In my pom.xml file, I'll add my Hypersql dependency by pressing Alt-Insert for Windows and Linux or Command-N for macOS. Then I'll choose Dependency. IntelliJ IDEA lets me search for my Hypersql database dependency. Once I find it, I will select the latest version to include in my pom.xml file. When the dependency is added and I save my file, I need to load my Maven changes. I can do so by pressing on Ctrl-Shift-O on Windows and Linux or Shift-Command-I on macOS. I can also click on the icon that appears in the top right-hand side of my pom.xml file. Now that our dependencies are all set, let's start creating the files needed for our persistence application. We'll open up our persistence tool window by pressing Shift twice and searching for persistence. This window allows us to create a variety of resources for our persistence applications. You'll see that IntelliJ IDEA created a persistence.xml configuration file where we'll configure our managed persistence classes as well as our database. In addition, a default persistence unit is created for us. Let's create an entity which will represent an employee. We can do so by right-clicking on our default persistence unit, then clicking New and clicking Entity. We'll call the entity class Employee and put it in a new package called Entity. Since the package currently doesn't exist, it'll be shown in red, and once we click on OK, IntelliJ IDEA will create the new Entity package along with our Employee class. IntelliJ IDEA will create our Employee object with a generated ID along with its setters and getters. According to the Jakarta Persistence specification, an entity must have a no-arg constructor. So let's generate it by bringing up the Generate window using Alt-Insert for Windows and Linux or Command-N for macOS. We'll choose Constructor, then select None so we can generate a constructor with no arguments. We can see that IntelliJ IDEA created a new arg constructor. Now let's add a couple more variables to our employee entity. I'll add a variable for the employee's first name. We'll call it fname, which isn't the best variable name, but we'll be changing that later in the video. We'll also add a variable for the employee's last name. You'll notice that the employee entity has some gutter icons. The gutter icon on the entity class declaration allows you to navigate to the persistence tool window. There are also gutter icons for your entity's persistent fields. IntelliJ IDEA will distinguish ID fields with a small key icon. You'll notice that the ID field has two gutter icons, one for the field access and one for the property access. Let's go ahead and generate the setters and getters for my new field. I'll bring up the Generate menu and select Getter and Setter. I'll press Ctrl to select both variables and then click OK. IntelliJ IDEA generates the getters and setters for both variables. Now that our employee entity is complete, let's create our main class where we'll create an employee object and persist it to a database. We'll select the Java folder in my project window and bring up the new menu by pressing Alt Insert for Windows and Linux or Command N for Mac OS. Choose Java class and then type in our class name. I'll call it main. In our new class, let's add a main method. I'll type in main and press enter, letting IntelliJ IDEA complete the declaration for me. Now I'll create the employee object that will persist to our database. We'll create the employee and set the first and last name. Now the first step to persisting my employee is to create an entity manager factory. You'll notice that if we type EMF, IntelliJ IDEA will bring up the Entity Manager Factory class, so we can just select that. IntelliJ IDEA will also suggest a variable name, so we'll use that as well. We'll call the persistence.createEntityManagerFactory method and pass in our persistence unit name. In this case, it's default. Next, we'll create the Entity Manager by calling the Entity Manager Factory's createEntityManager method. Once we do that, we can now begin a transaction by calling getTransaction.begin. And now we can persist our employee object. Now that's done, we can clean up our resources, we'll commit our transaction, and close our Entity Manager and Entity Manager Factory. At this point, we're almost ready to persist our data. The main step missing is setting up the database where our data will be persisted. You'll remember earlier in the video, we mentioned that we'll be using Hypersql as our database. So let's go ahead and set up our database. We'll open up our persistence window and navigate to our persistence.xml file. We see that our employee entity has already been configured in our default persistence unit. Let's add the Jakarta Persistence properties required to configure our Hypersql database. As soon as I start typing the opening tag, IntelliJ IDEA brings up suggestions for all the elements that go into a persistence unit element. I'll choose properties and press enter so I can start adding each of my property element. Similarly, when I select property, IntelliJ IDEA automatically inserts the property element with the name and value attribute. For my first property, I want to specify the JDBC driver to use for my database. I'll enter in the Jakarta Persistence JDBC driver property name, and for the value, I'll type in the Hypersql JDBC driver class. Then I need to specify the database URL. So I'll type in the URL property name. Then for my value, I want my program to create an embedded Hypersql database for me when it runs. So I will specify my URL to create an embedded database in my project's target directory and call my database MyDB. I'll also set the shutdown property to true so that the database will close with the last connection. Next, I will specify a username and password for the database. Finally, I will add the Jakarta schema generation property. This property will result in my entities table being generated for me in the database. I'll specify the property name and set the value to create so that my employee table will be created for me in the database. Another option is to set this property to drop and create. I like to set this value when I'm in the process of creating an entities definition and haven't finalized my schema yet. Now that we've finished configuring our database, let's go back to our main class and run our application. We can run our application by pressing Ctrl-Shift-F10 for Windows and Linux or Ctrl-Shift-R for macOS. Once our application runs, a HyperSQL database will be created as well as an employee table. Then our employee object will be persisted to our database table. At this point, you might want to view the tables that were created for you in the database. So let's configure IntelliJ IDEA to connect to the database that was created by our application. We'll need the database URL, so let's navigate to our persistence.xml file and copy the URL value. Remember that specifying this URL resulted in our application creating an embedded database called MyDB. We'll now connect to this database and see the data that was persisted into our database. After copying the URL, let's open the database window, then click on the Add button, choose Data Source from URL, then paste in our URL. In this case, IntelliJ IDEA already loaded it in and detected that it's a HyperSQL URL. Then click OK. We'll finish configuring the database information. I'll give this database configuration a name, MyDB. I'll enter in the username and password that we specified earlier in my persistence.xml file. And then under the Options tab, I will enable the Auto Disconnect setting and set it to disconnect after 3 seconds. This setting will disconnect the database in IntelliJ IDEA and release all locks, allowing my applications process to continually connect and write to the database. Then I will test my connection and make sure my configuration is valid. Then I can click OK. We now see the MyDB database show up in our database window. We see that the database contains an employee table under the default public schema. When we double-click on the table, we see that our employee entity is persisted into an employee table with an ID, FName, and LName column. We also see the data from the employee object we created in our main class. Now that we have our database configured, let's connect this data source to our persistence unit by right-clicking on the default persistence unit and selecting Assign Data Sources. Then we can choose our database from the drop-down menu. Next, I want to persist another employee object. So I'll go back to my main class and create another employee. I can take advantage of the code I already wrote earlier, and all I need to do is set my new employee's first and last name. I also want to make some adjustments to my employee object, so I'll navigate to my employee class. I want to rename my variables and give them a better name. I'll press Shift F6, then click Include My Accessors and rename my field from FName to FirstName. I'll do the same for the last name variable and replace LName with last name. Now let's try to rerun our application so we can persist our second employee. You'll notice that we get an error saying that the first name object was not found. This error happens because the first time the employee object was created, the column name was FName, as you can see in the database view showing the existing table. When we try to persist with the new first name variable name, it doesn't recognize it. We can either drop the employee table and start from scratch, or if we have existing data in our table and we can't drop the table, we can add a column annotation that maps the entities variable to the database column. I'll add the add column annotation. And for my name attribute, I can press Control Space for code completion. IntelliJ IDEA will bring up the current employee table column names, and I can choose FName from this list. Note that the database auto-completion is only available after you assign your persistence unit to your data source, as we saw a few steps ago. We'll similarly add the add column annotation to the last name variable. Now let's try to rerun our application. We see that the application ran successfully, and when we open the employee table, we see that the second employee was persisted. If you're wondering why the ID jumped from 1 to 51 between our runs, it's because by default, the JPA provider, EclipseLink, reserves 50 numbers for generated IDs. So you'll notice that every time you run your application, the generated ID will jump by 50. In this video, we created a Jakarta Persistence application that persisted an employee entity into a database. You can find a link to the GitHub repository used in this video in the description. Thanks for watching.